Tonight, on Life on the Rock, we'll discuss the call to a religious vocation with Sister Clare Matthiass. We'll watch a short film called Truth Speaks Volumes. We'll learn from Brother Leo how to talk about God, and much more.
Tonight on Life on the Rock, we're going to talk to Sister Clare Matthiass, and she's going to be talking about her book that she just wrote, Discerning Religious Life, and really enlightening us about what it means to truly discern your vocation. So any young women who are discerning might want to listen tonight. Father Leonard, do we have a friar segment tonight or anything?
Brother Leo is back, and with another episode of Building Your Faith. Tonight he's speaking to us about how to talk about God.
And now here's a Quarterly Catholic short film, Truth Speaks Volumes.
That which I tell you in the dark, speak ye in the light. And that which you hear in the ear, preach ye upon the housetops. I am the light of the world. He that followeth me walketh not in darkness, but shall have the light of life. I am the way and the truth and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me.
Sister Clare Matthiass, it's good to have you here, Life on the Rock and EWTN.
Thank you, Father.
It's good
to
have you here. And we're going to talk about religious life, about discerning religious life. Now, you just wrote this book, Discerning Religious Life, and I just want to highly recommend this book and just thank you, first of all, for writing this book. Your founder, Father Andrew Apostoli of Blessed Memory, we just really came out of him passing into eternal life. Mm-hmm. Talk about your founder and his influence on you and your own vocation and your community and this book even.
Yes. Well, thank you, Father. Thank you for bringing up our beloved Father Andrew, who, of course, we love and miss so very much. And Father Andrew Apostoli was the founder of the CFR Sisters. He was one of the eight founders of the Friars, but he really was our founder. And we really look to him as our not only our founder, but he was involved in our life, saying Mass for us, acting as our spiritual director for many of us, not all of us. He was my spiritual director for the last 18 years. So just, you know, I could just go on about the spiritual gift of himself that he imparted to me. And I'm just tremendously grateful. And all the sisters are, you know, on the one hand, there's joy when someone so holy goes on to heaven, which we're all aiming for. And you just can't help but feel a sense of joy for him. But the sorrow is for us you know, we sure do miss him. We sure do miss him. But he supported, you know, he was just the biggest proponent for a religious life.
Yes,
and he himself model religious and model Franciscan. And he loved vocation work. And so he was tremendously encouraging to me in my own vocation work. And then when this project came up, he was two thumbs up, sister, go for it. He said, go for it. And he was kind enough at the end, even though he really wasn't well, to read it and to give a little endorsement.
Now, I heard his voice. When I read this book, I could hear him almost speaking through you. So, you know, let's talk about that. He talked about the first stirrings of a call. You did, rather you did. But talk about what does that mean, the first stirrings of a call?
Well, first of all, thank you for the compliment, because the fact that you can say that you hear Father Andrew in that book is just a tremendously kind and gracious thing to say. And he has definitely been part of everything in my spiritual life, so it's not, I guess it shouldn't be too surprising, it's nice to hear. But the first stirrings of a call, it's mysterious, you know, and as the more women I speak with, the more I realize it's so different for every person. And for some, as a little girl, at Sunday Mass with her family, sitting there singing, "Here I Am, Lord," and all of a sudden, it just, it means so much, and it's this prayer from the heart, and something is happening there, and then she can later look back and say, that was it, that was starting right then. And then others, it's not until maybe their high school years at a retreat, others, you know, older, moments at Mass, moments in prayer, moments out with friends and realizing this isn't what I want.
Yeah.
This isn't what I want. So it's very different for every single person, but the ability to let those moments of stirring, to be able to reflect on them and to listen to what the Lord was really saying. That's what discernment is all about. What is
listening.
The Lord really saying?
75% of any good conversation is listening, really. Listening to what somebody is saying. Not so much talking, but just listening. The second chapter is really the agony of discernment.
Yes.
And I love that because you have this prayerful girl on this cover.
Looking anything but
like she's going through agony. And you talk about the agony of discernment. What is the agony of discernment?
Well, that's a self-description, Father. That's my own discernment that I'm describing there. And
everybody's.
I didn't have a clue, to put it quite simply. I didn't have a clue what I was doing. I was just beginning to be open to the possibility that God might be calling me to religious life. And to be honest, that filled me with a bit of fear and dread. And I thought, like the facial expression that goes along with my discernment at that stage was like, you know, I didn't want that necessarily. Now, that was for a lot of different reasons, misconceptions and stereotypes and all kinds of things. And it was an agony. It was an agony because my trust in God was low and my fears were high. And I think there's a ratio between trust and fear. And as my trust in the Lord grew, my fears diminished and I was able to open my heart more and more to discernment. So it was an agony in the beginning, and the book is meant to help it be less of an agony for others.
Do you see that in women, in dealing with them as a vocation director, this pulling, this pull, tug and pull?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. It is such a journey, and the fears are very pronounced, I think, for all of us, for many different things. Fears, this is how the enemy gets at us and tries to shackle us down from moving forward in the will of God. And so we grapple with fears all the time, and the young women that I work with and young women discerning really are often, you know, struggling with their own fears, and that's why it's very helpful to be able to name them and not let it be this ominous cloud of nameless fear.
And you say that in your book, to actually write them down, you know, to almost write to create like a discernment journal, and to just claim it and write it, and just so you can go back to that.
Exactly. Well, and just the act of articulating it and pinpointing it, so it's not just I'm afraid or I'm anxious, but I'm afraid of
this.
Loneliness,
yes.
Or I'm afraid I'll never be a mother, or I'm afraid that my parents will disown me. Hmm. Whatever the fear is, when we can pinpoint it, then we can bring that to the Lord and even bring that to another person and talk that through and get very specific guidance and very often dispel the fear altogether. Like, I'm afraid I'll be miserable because religious deep down inside are miserable. Well, I talk to a religious about that and they say, no, we're not. Oh, okay, great. It's a misconception, it's a stereotype, it's not true.
Sure. Well, sister, when we come back, we're going to address that exactly, fear, because I noticed that's the biggest chapter in here, is fear, and then the chapter afterwards where you talk about the six-month discernment challenge. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we're going to address some of the fears that we might as just, especially women discerning religious life, we're going to address that fear.
Excellent.
Clare Matthiass. It's great for you to be here again, and thank you again for this book. I think I just want to state right off the bat that I think that people watching, I want them to buy this book and just to have it in the background, rather in the back of churches, just for people that are discerning. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of times when we see something like this, you might pick it up and like, discerning religious life, you know, you kind of you hide it really quick, and but it'd be great to read for anybody.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
We're talking about fears, and there's a lot of them. Mm-hmm. You know, can you mention some of the fears that you face, perhaps, and just some of the your other sisters and women that you talk about in this book, what the fears that they might have faced?
Yeah, one of the big fears that I see a lot is unworthiness, the fear of unworthiness, that that maybe there's a certain person that's called, the holy person is called, the person that's already got it all figured out, or that's perfect, it might be called to religious life, but not me. How on earth could I be called? And this feeling of unworthiness. And this is disastrous. Yeah. It's disastrous because we're not worthy. I mean, the truth is, who's worthy? Nobody's worthy on this side of heaven. Yeah. And that gets in the way because we're aiming for holiness for sure, but we're not there yet. And I just simply usually guide young women just to say, you know, forget about that. You know, you're not worthy, but God chooses who he wants. You know, it's his call. It's his choice, and he chooses. And we just simply go to Mass, and we can just let the prayer of the Mass, you know, Lord, you know, I'm not worthy, but only say the word. Only say the word.
My soul shall be healed.
And my soul shall be healed.
Yeah. You know? And you talk about the fear of not being a mother. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a big one.
That's a big one.
But in religious life, talk about the reality of, you know, you won't be a biological mother, a natural mother, but you'll be a spiritual mother.
Right.
And that's huge. I think that's something that you don't realize at the beginning, but it's something that you, as you grow in your religious life, that you probably come to experience, that you're a spiritual mother.
So true, Father. That's exactly the case. And that is something that young women do have to grapple with in their discernment process, is it is a true renunciation, that they will not get married and they will not have children. And it's important to face the renunciation squarely. And to say, if this is what the Lord is asking of me, I can, with his help, make this offering. So that's important, but that's only the negative part of it.
Sure.
And the rest, what you're describing, is the spiritual motherhood, which is the positive part of it, that the Lord is calling us into a spousal relationship with himself.
Right.
And this spousal relationship is meant to bear fruit. It's meant to be fruitful. And it's his decision and his way and his life-giving spirit that makes it bear fruit in many, many different ways, which is often surprising, but spiritual,
it is surprising.
It is. You feel that as a father probably
yes,
as well.
Absolutely. And this is where I think I hear Father Andrew speaking in and through your book is, you know, his book, When God Asks for an Undivided Heart, he talks about the reality of the Lord inviting us to this relationship, to choose celibacy and love and freedom. To get to a point in our lives where it's not a list of no's, but it's an invitation that we say yes to, and that God is not forcing me to be a religious. I had to reach that point. It's like, no, I have to, it's an invitation, and I have to choose this every day. And I remember getting to that point of choosing, wanting to choose, and it was actually, I experienced more freedom in my vocation once I chose it for myself and didn't look at it as something forced.
Yes.
Can we talk about that?
Yes, thank you, Father. That is so important because, and it's a process to get to that point
as we
all experience and to grow in that. And all of the steps are important. So it is important to let go, to make a free renunciation of whatever it is that the Lord asks us to give up out of love.
Sure.
Out of love, not out of a sense of a servile slavery. I have this taskmaster who has this awful plan for me, but because he's God and I'm a creature, I'm going to do it. Oh, you know, that is not going to make a good vocation. So it has to come out of love, that the God who loves me, the God who created me, the God that has a beautiful design on my life, which is going to cause me to flourish, cause the salvation of souls, give glory to God, that I want to say yes to that. And I want to say yes to that in freedom because God is so good. Yeah. And all of this is coming now out of love and not out of a servile fear.
Yeah, out of a a father-son, a father-daughter relationship.
Exactly.
Not a slavery-type relationship. And there's freedom involved in that type of relationship. Now, talk about the discernment challenge. Mm-hmm. I love this. Mm-hmm. Talk about some of the aspects of that.
Sure. So I do recommend in the book the six-month challenge.
Okay.
And so when a young woman comes to me...
Or more, right?
Or more. It could go longer. But to have a set amount of time is what's key there. And we say, why are you putting a limit on God's timing? He can only call me up to 6 months and then I'm closed to the idea. That's not so much the intention. It's more that I don't think it's helpful to date and discern religious life simultaneously. It's disastrous. I know it because I've tried it.
Yes.
Doesn't work. You don't get very far. And the reason for that is we have to be free to discern. We have to be emotionally free, free to think about religious life as a real possibility, take steps in that discernment. And if I'm dating and trying to be open to religious life, I'm entangled in a very emotional relationship. We all know what that's like, falling in love. How can I be really free and open to religious life and entangled in a very good, perhaps a very good relationship? So because dating and discerning religious life really don't go together, it's helpful to set aside a set amount of time, because a young 21-year-old girl isn't going to go on a dating fast for the next 7 years while she figures out her vocation.
Right.
But she can imagine saying, you know what, I can take 6 months. I can take 6 months and just decide to focus all of my energy spiritually, my prayer, my thought, intellectually reading about religious life, my actions. I'm going to try to visit a community, and I'm going to do it within this time frame, partially so that there's an end in sight. Because after this time, if I don't feel a stirring in my heart, if it doesn't seem like God is calling, I'm going to be able to date again.
Yes.
See, it's not open-ended.
Yes. Sister, we can go, it seems like we can talk about this book and do a whole series on it.
Great idea.
it'd be nice to have you back to do it. Yeah.
Maybe we
can talk to Doug Keck about that.
Okay, sure.
Thank you so much.
You're
and again, special condolences to you and your community, and you're in our prayers, and know that you're always welcome here.
Thank you very much,
team.
Father. It's been such a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much.
Now here's Brother Leo with Building Your Faith.
Holy Mother Church teaches us in paragraphs 39 and 43 that we can speak about God. And it says, how can we speak about God? Because we can know God by reason alone, it means that we can explain God, talk about God using words to other people and explain that. And we must proclaim God, just like this microphone right here. I must proclaim God to the whole world. I must speak loudly and proclaim that there is a God, and I can prove it to you with proofs of the existence of God. Now these proofs that we have help us to explain that there is a God. But then the church also says our wording can get very complicated. God is simple, and yet we can really complicate things and make it very difficult to understand. And so the church says we need to purify our language when we're talking about God. Remember that we can make God into ourselves. Just right here is an impression tool. You see an impression of me. Not very good one, but it's an impression tool. Well, when we're talking about God, sometimes we bring God down to our level and we make him look like another person or a good man. And yet God is infinite. He is way over what we can understand. It's a mystery. God is a mystery. And when we talk about God, we have to make sure we don't lose that mystery. So we need to purify our language. It talks about that we need to use different types of speaking. So when I talk about God using analogies like I just did, when they're physical analogies, it's not quite the best ones, but yet they sometimes are easier to understand. But then when you get an analogy like this one where you talk about the sound coming out of this thing and you can't see the sound, it's more like God because it's invisible and you can't see it. And so there's a mystery to it. But when you talk about analogies using physical things, well then, you need to purify your language. We constantly need to grow in our understanding of God so that, like the church says, we can then preach God to those who don't believe, the atheists, those who do not even know there is a God, and we can preach God to them. And so when you play with these toys, or when you even have a megaphone, you can do all types of fancy stuff with it. See? And so you do all these things and you can learn about your faith at the same time and have fun and proclaim that there is a God to the whole world.
Brother Leo's segments are always interesting. He always is using creative means to communicate. Mm-hmm. This time he actually has a megaphone, and you can see that he actually liked using that.
Did he put that thing, that pins thing on his face and to portray an image?
Yeah, I mean, he actually looked like he was having fun. And you know Brother Leo has fun.
He has a lot of fun.
You know, he's talking about communicating and coming to know God, coming to know the God who has communicated himself to us, and the importance of what it means to communicate, that the Word of God came down, He took on flesh to communicate to us, and that we ourselves are called to be that extension. We're called to communicate the Word of God to others. And in religious life is about communicating our life, especially by the manner of our life of possibly living a life of poverty, chastity, and obedience. That's what Sister Clare came to talk to us about.
That's what we're striving to do, is we're striving to live the gospel radically and literally, especially us who are Franciscans, because that's our model. St. Francis of Assisi, he wanted to be a living word.
A living word.
A living word, and that's what communicating is all about, the way we speak and the way we live it. And basically, you know, we're talking about our best friend, Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Well, Sister talked about really the inner stirrings of a call.
Right.
Do you remember in your own discernment, Father Leonard, back, what was it like for you, those inner stirrings, you know? Was it scary at first?
It was scary because, you know, I was just fascinated with the life of the priest and, of course, the Franciscan way of living, but then I was scared, you know? One thing she mentions is, well, some people are afraid because they're lonely. That was my thing. I always had to have a date and all of that. But then, you know, the Lord brings us, he helps us. He shows us a way, especially when we keep praying about it. And so he showed me that I was actually happiest when I was alone with him.
I think everybody's vocation is unique, especially in religious life. I mean, it's unique but the same. It's to the same place, but everybody has that initial kind of that call, that draw to the religious life. You know, what actually was that spark? What was it that sparked them, a person to think about religious life? Father, what's our Into the Vineyard challenge this week?
Well, speaking about sparks, you know, we're going to ask you to help spark somebody's vocation. And so our Into the Vineyard challenge today is to encourage and support vocations. Yes, and we can do that really well by recognizing, I mean, especially all you ladies out there who are church ladies, you have the ability to see who would make a good priest, who would make a good sister or brother. You know, so it's time to encourage and support vocations out there in your church communities.
I think that's how it was with me. I mean, somebody encouraged me. First of all, it was my mother, and I can remember actually almost yelling at her, saying, "You're ridiculous, Mom." And then it was the ladies at church who saw me going to Mass almost every day and then going to adoration. But really, it was somebody my own age. That's when it really kind of hit home. Somebody my own age said, you know what, I think that you might have a vocation to the priesthood. I think you have the qualities of what it takes to be a good priest. And so maybe it might be somebody out there that's young to encourage somebody your own age to have or to think about a vocation. So we want to send you out with a blessing to bless each one of you and your families. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he turn his face to you and be merciful to you. May he show you his kindness and give you his peace. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. See you next time on Life on the Rock. God bless.